Welcome to the third tutorial in the Simple Microcontroller series. In this tutorial, we're going to talk more about the architecture and the memory and the registers of the PIC10F200. So we're going to go over a little bit about how that all works and how it's important to you. So first of all, we talked about earlier, and I think it was the first tutorial, how there's only 256 words of flash memory or program memory in the PIC10F200. Now the Atmega328P has 32K of flash memory, and you'll notice that I'm saying 320K of bytes versus 256 words. And you thought, that's weird. Why does the PIC10F200 have 256 words while the Atmega has 32K bytes? It's because the PIC has a constant instruction length of 12 bits. And so if we took it out and we multiplied 256 words times 12 bits and then divided by 8 to get the amount of actual bytes it is, that would come out to be 384 bytes. Okay, that doesn't mean anything. What we want to know is how many instructions we can put in and actually use, which is 256. So if there is any confusion about that, just wanted to put that out. And that is why we say words versus bytes, because the bytes just don't make a whole lot of sense. And the words do, and moving on. So let's go over really quick a couple of the stats of the microcontroller. And the first one is the microcontroller runs at 4 megahertz. Now each instruction takes 4 cycles or 4 ticks to execute. So in reality, you can execute 1 million instructions per second. So even though we have the 4 million clock cycle, we have 1 million instructions per second. We also have 3 GPIOs, which are general purpose input output pins, so that they can be used as either an input to measure something or to receive data from something else, or as an output when you want to light up an LED or communicate with something else. And we also have 1 just input pin. It cannot be changed. And so you have 3 input output and 1 input pin. Let's look at the actual pinout really quick. And you can see that if you have a 6-pin package, you're using up all of the pins, but since we're using a DIP, you'll notice that there are 2 no-connect pins. That's because there's no reason for them, but the standard 8-pin package is what they used for the DIP. So we'll ignore those no-connects, and you'll notice that other than VDD, which is power, and VSS, which is ground, all of the other pins are shared. Like it says GPIO3 along with something else. What that means is basically within the program itself, you can say, I want to use this as either a clearing pin to do a master reset, or I want to use it as a GPIO. And as you program it, you make that selection. So as I mentioned, there's GPO through GP2, so GPO, GP1, GP2, and those are the input-output pins. And then there's GP3, which is the input only. And then you've got MClear, which has a bar over it, which basically means that when it's high, it's inversed. So that basically means that to clear it, you want to pull that down instead of put it up. So that's what that bar means when you look at the symbol there. And then there is the ICSP, in-circuit serial programming clock, CLK, and the ICSP data. And those are just lines that when you're communicating with your programmer, those are what you connect so that your programmer can actually control the microcontroller and send in what program needs to be in there to run it. Right. Okay, so that is what we have to work with here. Now let's talk really quickly about the software that you put on there, the firmware. So you have the flash memory, and this is where you put in your data, and this is the program that you actually want to run. And when you remove power from it, that data stays in there. That's very important, and that's different from the data memory that we'll go over in a second. So there's a lot of things to think about, but we're only going to worry about a couple of things in this video. If you want to get into a little bit more depth, the written tutorial has a little bit more detail. But for right now, I just want to focus on the fact that you have your addresses that go from 0000H, which H stands for hexadecimal, to 00FFH. And if you are confused about the Fs and you don't know what hexadecimal is, we strongly recommend you learn more about that before moving on, because we'll use that all the time. So within that space, you have a lot of different things, but the big things are the PC, the program counter. The reason this is so important is because this actually tells your controller where you are in the program. It takes a program and it moves from line to line, and it executes this, then it moves to the next one, executes this, moves to the next one. But there are certain commands that'll make it jump around to different places, and that PC, that program counter, will change. Basically, if you use a go-to or some sort of subroutine, it'll change that, which actually brings me to the next thing that we need to worry about, and that is the stack. So you have 2 levels of stack in this microcontroller. What happens is when your program counter is going along and it goes and does a subroutine, let's say you want a delay subroutine, and it says, oh, okay, I'm gonna jump down here and execute that code, what it's doing is it's remembering where it was by taking that program counter, putting it into the stack, putting the new program counter in so it goes down to the subroutine you want, runs that subroutine, pulls that address back from the stack, and then goes back up into the place that it was in the program. Now, the reason there's two is because sometimes you'll be in a subroutine and you'll want to call another subroutine. And so it'll take that address and stick that into the stack as well, run that other subroutine, go back to the first subroutine, and then go back to the very original place that you were at. Now, if you want to call a subroutine inside of a subroutine inside of a subroutine, it'll fail. There's not enough space in the stack. There's only two levels. So you might forget this right now, but sometime you're gonna try and do that and it's not gonna work and you're gonna be like, ah, yes, that's what I did wrong. You can only do that twice because you run out of space in that stack and the whole program just crashes. And finally, we have the data memory. Unlike the flash memory for the program, this memory gets erased every time it loses power. And this is where you have things like the special function registers and where you keep your variables. It acts like your RAM. So really quick, I want to go over the special function registers. There's quite a few of them. They take the space from 00 to 10. And the biggest things that we're going to be using at first are going to be the GPIO register, which is where you can control the output of the pins. That's where you say, write a 1 to this pin or write a 0 so it's high or low. And then there's the TRISC GPIO register, which is where you control whether or not that pin is an input or an output. So we're gonna be using those quite a bit from the very beginning. And so those are the two biggest ones. For the rest of the registers, we briefly go over them in the written tutorial, but again, they're not quite as important at this point and we'll cover them later. Now finally, since we have 10H for our special function registers, we have from 10 to 1F for our variables. And so if you look at that, you can see obviously we have 16 bytes of variables that we can use, or 16 bytes of RAM before we just run out of space. And so again, the PIC10F200 is a very simple, very small microcontroller, but we're still gonna be able to do some pretty crazy things with it. And that's it. So now we've gone over kind of the basic architecture of the PIC10F200, why we use words instead of bytes to talk about the programming space. We talked about the stats, so how many GPIOs we have available, the clock speed and stuff like that. We also talked about the program memory, how that works, the things that we need to worry about here at the beginning. And then we also talked about the data memory, how that works, and the things that we can change and that we need to change. Hope you found this video interesting. Hope that you come back and join us on the next tutorial. We basically only have one more tutorial before we actually start building the circuit and start doing things with it. But right now we're laying that foundation and we're getting some good stuff so that we're ready to move forward. Like this video, subscribe to our channel, and we'll catch you on the next one.